John Nott, Secretary of State for Trade. Mr. Nott, what we have heard this week in various forms, albeit perhaps a little muted from Mr. Rigby, are cries of help from British industry. Do those cries fall upon deaf ears in the government?
No, of course not. I mean, industry is under considerable pressure at the moment. It's worried about its cash position. It's worried that its margins, particularly its export margins, are being eroded. We understand the position, but we must not lose sight of the long-term strategy of the government, which is fundamental to the conquest of inflation.
But what the criticism that is being made, and it's been made in other quarters than Mr. Healy, is that this government, and of which you're a leading exponent, is a monetarist government, but that it is too strict in its application of its own theories.
Well, I understand that criticism is made, but we have said that we believe that for the future conquest of inflation, it's important we keep within the government's expressed monetary targets. We have brought monetary growth down sharply from 15% to about 11% in the last year. There's been a strong change in the position, but we must just not lose our nerve now. Things are going the right way. Within a few months, we believe interest rates will come down.
Things are going the right way. Inflation is up to 20%. Interest rates are up. The balance of payments is in a bad situation. Which bits of your policy are going the right way, Mr. Nott?
We have a long-term strategy to improve the competitiveness of this economy, to restore incentives, to put this country back on its feet, and we're not going to achieve that, and nor would any other government, in 13 months. Now, it is the medium long-term health of this nation that counts, not the short-term statistics. But if you want me to tell you the things that are going right in the short term, fortunately, wholesale prices are beginning to fall. Export volume has held up remarkably well in spite of the strong pound. Market interest rates are beginning to come down now, and I believe it won't be very long before the government can come along with a reduction in the MLR. But of course, sterling does remain strong. That has advantages as well as disadvantages.
Are you with Mr. Biffen in suggesting to us that things are going to get worse before they get better? Is there still not only a long tunnel, but a very dark tunnel ahead?
I certainly foresee that during the next 5 or 6 months, the situation in certain areas will deteriorate. Yes, I think the unemployment figures are likely to rise. Everything depends in the short term on this winter's pay settlements. If we can, for instance, keep pay settlements down to 10% or so, then I foresee that next year we could have very much lower levels of inflation. So the next crucial thing in the economy is persuading people that if they are determined to settle way above the output of the economy, then we're in for a very difficult time.
How do you persuade trade union leaders in the private sector who look at 20% inflation, who look at 1.5 million unemployed, who look at the general increasing difficulties of their members to pay mortgages because of interest rates? How do you persuade them to keep it at 10%?
But it's perfectly well understood on the shop floor. I could quote you 500 examples of small and medium-sized firms whose people, whose trade union members on the shop floor understand the realities perfectly well. A BL settled at a reasonable figure because the workforce was concerned about the future of their company. Now that is perfectly well understood on the shop floor. Of course the trade union leaders make their speeches as I make mine, but the trade union leaders in the last resort can't deliver. The only people who can deliver on pay are the people who are actually working on the shop floor and settling within the reality of their own firm circumstances.
The strategy of this government does seem to be to ignore the leaders of the TUC and to somehow or other speak over their heads or round them or through them to the rank and file who you think are getting the message quicker than them?
No one's ignoring the leaders of the TUC.
You're not bending over backwards to listen, are you?
We sit with the leaders of the TUC on the National Economic Development Council. I've invited the TUC Economic Committee to come and meet me and discuss import problems. They haven't yet come, but we're always open to discuss matters with the TUC if they want to come along.
Do you find them out of touch?
I don't think they're out of touch, but certainly for the time being they apparently have lost a fair amount of their influence with their own membership. So that's why I say, and I think I'm entitled to say it, I don't believe at the present moment that it would be sensible for any government to do a deal with the TUC on the economy generally, when they're in no position to deliver on pay.
If you don't get this across the board 10% that you hope for, what will you do?
Well, that's speculation into the future.
That's what politicians do.
No, well, I don't. As far as I'm concerned, we have a short-term, crucial problem of persuading this nation that they must accept pay settlements at a realistic level, realistic in terms of output, of what firms are producing. If we can do that, then next year the inflation rate will look infinitely better.
Mrs. Thatcher seems to have very much ruled out any U-turns, which I presume would be an incomes policy, but a wage freeze wouldn't be a U-turn, would it?
Oh, a wage freeze in current circumstances seems to me to be out of the question. Of course, no one can rule out a wage freeze in any circumstances, and I don't think any of us would ever seek to do so. But there's no question of a wage freeze at the present moment.
If wages start running away in the winter, you start getting 14, 15, 16%, still not a wage freeze?
Well, it's very important that the government, as an employer in the economy, takes a firm line so far as public sector pay is concerned. In the private sector, the realities of the position, which Mr. Rigby and Mr. Healy was discussing, will, I'm sure, convince people on the shop floor that they must settle for a sensible amount. I don't doubt that that will happen.
This is exhortation week, isn't it, in a way?
It seems to be.
I just wonder, you see, Mrs. Thatcher was implying in the House of Commons the other day that factories close or lay off people because, she seemed to imply, because of their lack of efficiency. But if I put to you two recent cases, Courtaulds, recognised efficient firm, sacked 600 people because of the turn down in textile industry. Lucas, motor accessories, 3,000 to be made redundant because of the turn down in the home car market and because they say they can't sell abroad because of the size of the rate of the pound. Now, that's nothing to do with productivity. They can't make productivity won't help them, will it?
Well, we live in a world in which everybody's competing very strongly with each other, and fashion and technology is changing the whole time. Now, one of the problems of Courtaulds, as far as I'm aware, is that, for instance, fashions in that market are changing. Nylon fibres, which were a very important part of Courtaulds' production, are no longer as important as they were. That is a change in the fashion of the market. Now, Courtaulds will adapt, it's a very good company, to the new demand for products in the textile market. Lucas is clearly concerned about the fall in the world demand for motor cars at the present time. That's a factor which the government itself can't affect. There is a depression in world trade. People are not buying as many motor cars at the moment. That's a fact of life, unfortunately, for Lucas.
But you see, what industry, and we come back to where we started, is what industry is beginning to say is, if there is going to be anything to rise from the ashes, if there are even going to be ashes left at the end of your policies, you are going to have to give them, the successful firms, some help now.
Look, industry is never, there's no question of any firms going into the ashes. Some firms, I'm afraid, because of changing markets, because of low productivity, will be in great difficulties. The fact of the matter is that one third of everything we produce in this country is exported into world markets. We export more of our manufacturing output in relation to the size of our total production than any other nation in the world. Now, I don't believe any of this rubbish about manufacturing industry going under. It simply isn't true.
People
talk
about
it. It's a scare story which bears no reality, bears no relationship to the facts.
1.5 million unemployed now. That's not a scare story, is it, Mr. Nott?
No,
what will it reach?
No. Well, I hope that we do better than Mr. Healy. During his time, and he's of course now a great pundit, but in his time, unemployment doubled, the national debt doubled, prices doubled, and yet he comes along on programs like this and poses as an expert on how to put the situation right. I wouldn't be so presumptuous if I'd just lost an election in which mainly trades unionists had put me in power, the Conservatives in power.
How long before you begin to get it right, before we actually see some benefits from the policies that people supposedly voted you into power on?
In my view, next year we will begin to see some of the indicators, some of the statistics which you mentioned, turning round the right way. I believe that within 3 years the economy will have been turned round from the disastrous situation which we had a year ago after the winter of discontent, and it will be pointing in the right direction. That we need 10 years to get this country really back on its feet.
Well, we'll see whether you get it or not, Mr. Nott. Thank you very much. From TVI, from a still confident spokesman from the government, Mr. John Nott, from all of us here, good night to you.